incorporate that into your painting. But you have to learn one or the other, and then once you learn that one, then you can start learning the other. Does it make sense? So stop trying to design and paint, guys, if you don't know how to paint. Okay, this is a lot. I see a lot of work from students that are trying to be concept artists that don't put the effort into the painting, into the actual the part that makes us the artist. Because there's a lot of people that can design, right? But that's why they hire artists, because they can't draw it. Okay, and so you know it takes more than just painting too to be able to design. So I just want to be upfront with you guys and say, you know, if you look in your work and you don't see that that your painting or your drawing or your whatever your skill is, if you don't see it at any value at this moment, then the solution is
hard work.
Yeah. Practice it, and then eventually you start sucking at design, and then the same question comes out. So how do you practice your design? Hard work. And so I'm gonna give you guys some tips and strategies on what I've done, but I'm gonna clarify. I'm gonna show you guys some imagery. So I always say versus and or, like design versus painting, design and painting, design or painting. You gotta make up your mind what you're doing. Okay, if you're studying, then don't try to be designing. Okay, don't try to design something if you're trying to practice. If you're trying to practice, then practice. Okay, look at like a giraffe and try to draw the giraffe. Don't put like wings on it and then like make it have like laser eyeballs. Practice, try to draw the giraffe. If you can draw that giraffe, then you can design that giraffe laser shooting eyeball thingy. But you have to make up your mind, like, are you practicing? Or are you like designing? If you're trying to design, then you know, you don't even have to paint to design. You can just draw shapes. You know, you can draw just very simple line art without any little tangency to it. You can just say, this is kind of my dragon giraffe flying thingy. And people can be like, oh yeah, totally. And then you can do the whole design and painting where you do it all together and then you make that freaking awesome dragon giraffe. Okay? That might be my demo. No, I'm not gonna pick up, damn. Okay. So let me give you guys examples of someone that can paint very well, right? So this is a pumpkin. It's a nicely painted pumpkin. But there's nothing designed about it, really, right? It's just like this guy probably had a pumpkin on his little stool and just said, I'm going to paint this. And he painted it. He fucking did it. You know? And then here's my friend Paul. He's designing pumpkins, right? These aren't nearly as good as the painting. When it comes to the painting, but when it comes to design, these are much more interesting to look at, right? Because he fabricated them and he designed them. He put some aesthetic appeal to them. They're not just a pumpkin on a pedestal, okay? And so this is like a clear example between designing and painting. Hopefully you guys can see it, all right? And there's value in both. There's value in just practicing your painting skills, and there's value in just practicing your design skills, okay? There's no wrong answer, but you just gotta make up your mind is what I'm trying to get at. Again, this is a, whoopsies. Okay, this is a, by Odo Schmidt, I don't know, this is Russian. I don't know if there's like a in there, or I don't know if that's even Russian. But he's designing like this really nice looking chick. It's very, very pretty and very aesthetically powerful, right? And then here's just like, a painting of a chick as well. But this is basically photo replicant, right? And yes, this is painted, by the way. You know, and this is the thing, a lot of people are so amazed by this, more so than this, which is kind of like, I think they should be on equal grounds, where, you know, designing has its merits and it obviously is very valuable, especially it's very appealing when you're trying to sell something, right? Because you're trying to say, this is the different product, right? That's what they were trying to do with the whole Call of Duty versus Battlefield 3. But it's like, it was so hard to kind of distinguish between them both because they're essentially the same thing, right? Except one has jets. And so, which is actually that's why I like that one better. But you know, those are so close together, but it's so much easier to look at Halo versus Call of Duty, right? You're like, there's definitely a crowd for each game, right? And that's kind of how I see it. Like, one's Halo, one's Call of Duty, right? And so, you know, this is painted, and there's a lot of value in being able to paint that well as well. But there's sometimes you'll see painters that can paint extremely well, but they can't draw something like this. And you think this would be easier to draw, right? No, you're wrong. You would be wrong. If this was easy, then everyone would be doing this. And if this was easy, then everybody would be doing this. So neither of these are easy. So the secret again is
hard work.
Hard work. All right. You guys are getting it. I wasn't sure you're gonna get it. And you know, and there's people that can do a little bit of both. They can paint really good and design pretty good as well, right? Again, more of the same. Paint really good, design really good. Paint really good, design really good. Paint freaking crazy good.
Wow.
And design freaking crazy good. So there's room for both. You know, and it, if you zoom in, like, you can see that these are painted rocks too. They're not like a texture or nothing. This guy's a monster. Sam Kim. He's up and coming. I don't think anyone really knows him. But he's pretty boss. But this is kind of what I wanted to talk about. It's like, you know, they are different, but you can put them together and they can become one. Like Mighty Morphin Power Ranger type stuff. All right. So, does anyone have any questions before I kind of go into this next section? Maybe. Actually, you can save it for the end. It's fine. Yes.
You said like it's easier if you start, you know, if you get design down and you can work on your painting. And if you got painting down, then you start working on your design. Where did you start?
I started painting because I didn't know how. I thought it was very important to learn how to draw if I wasn't an artist. If I wanted to be an artist and I didn't have any drawing background, I thought it was pretty important. And so I did a lot of line drawing and I did a lot of painting. So, yes. It is important to start with one. I know people that start the other way around, that are very good designers, and then they started practicing their painting. Like Paul Richards is a great example of that. He just drew all the time, line art. That's essentially designing at its essence. And he's like getting his painterliness in there. Another one is Callum Alexander Watt, who did a lot of just line art, and he's like now getting really phenomenal at his painting. So it is dangerous when that happens. I feel like if you're coming from the other spectrum to painting, that's some dangerous stuff. because like us painters are way too technical. We're like, oh, it's gotta look perfect. And we forget that our design's just stupid. So anyway, design theory. So, design theory, I'm gonna talk about a few things. So since I was talking about design and I was talking about painting, right? I'm gonna talk about what I think is important in my design theory. Now, before I start going into any further in design theory and painting theory, I wanna make it very clear that a lot of this stuff that I'm saying is my honest opinion, okay? And I truly believe that making facts and rules is kind of a wrong way of thinking about art, okay? And even design, or even anything, really. The greatest innovators of this time and times before have took what existed and put it together and said, this should be what it should be, you know? Made something better. And so I think that's what it should be. And so I kind of make vague words of purpose because that can always evolve and change. But I'll go into it. But I just want to make sure that you guys know that a lot of what I'm saying is what's important to me, and it can be important to you, okay? And so, anyways, let's talk about that. So when I'm designing, I think about these few things. I think about purpose, clarity, and inspire, okay? The reason why I think about purpose, and I think this is why a lot of people fail at concept art, is they don't understand that sometimes the art they're doing is not for them. Okay, and that's it hurts your feelings. It really does. When you draw a picture, you're like, and they don't like it. You're just like, what do you know about art, right? And honestly, you got to get over that. You got to get over that kind of mentality because especially if they're paying you, then yeah, you definitely get over yourself because they're essentially paying you to help them realize their designs, realize their passion, their whatever they want you to draw, little ponies, whatever. The purpose of it. It's really important to understand, like, am I working on a movie? Because all kinds of rules change from there. If you're working on a movie, a lot of things change. Am I working on a video game? A lot of things change. Am I working for a comic? Am I making my own project? You know, what are you doing artwork for? If you can figure that out, then you can do the best kind of artwork for it, all right? I mean, how many of you guys know what it takes to work in the film industry? Nobody, right? Maybe a few people think they know, right? I still don't know, because it's such a random thing, right? But you know, I can tell you a few things about it. They constantly want to make things like look very realistic, and they want like the lighting to feel very realistic. And so sometimes it gets very boring, in my opinion, because it's like I'm just drawing very realistic stuff all the time. I feel like I can't push the limits. But some filmmakers aren't like that, so that's not a general case. That's just every once in a while. But still, a video game is much different, right? Video games like. It can be somewhat realistic, but honestly, it has to fit the gameplay. As long as it looks, or as long as it makes the game feel more fun, then we don't care, really, essentially, how far or how much you don't put into it, right? Because if the game starts losing the fun because of the artwork, then the artwork is doing a terrible job. Here's a good example of things in the wrong situation, right? People here may not like the Transformers movies. Who likes the Transformers movies? That's probably... I love the Transformers movies, except for the second one. The second one was kind of garbage. But the first one I loved a lot. And I hear a lot of people, I heard boos. Like, this movie made millions of dollars. $300 million. If people didn't really like it, they wouldn't have watched it. Yeah. Right? And the point is that maybe it wasn't made for you. It was made for all the little kids that loved the crap out of this movie. And I've had arguments with my friends and my colleagues about this. They're like, oh, they ruined my childhood. And I was like, no, they didn't. You don't remember your childhood. That's what happened. Because Transformers was never an epic odyssey. It was never, there was a guy called Soundwave who turned into a cassette player. You can't tell me there was some rich story in that. Like, and it was always for kids. It was always a kid's thing. And to think that it wasn't is kind of, you know, yes, it's nostalgic. And I had a lot of nostalgic factor when I also was like, yeah, whatever, but I can get past that because I thought that was pretty cool, the Transformer robots. It was pretty groundbreaking with individuals. And then you look at something that's obvious for kids, right? Like Sesame Street, right? Everybody agrees that Sesame Street was awesome, but you don't watch it anymore because you've grown out of it, right? And so it's kind of like this blur between Transformers and Sesame Street that I see. But it's very clear that you could take Elmo and put Elmo into the Transformers series and have him running around with Shia, you know, like, oh, God! You know, it wouldn't work. And then you can't take Bumblebee. Well, you probably could. They probably have a special. But still, you get what I'm saying. You can't put, like, Megatron up in Sesame Street blasting fools. because the purpose, that wouldn't serve the purpose. But they all have their place, is what I'm saying. Okay? Like, you can have the crazy epic dragon, but he has to fit in the world that he set in. Okay? And you can have the little kiddish actor in his own movie. You know, it all makes sense. And, you know, that's why I think the second one was terrible, because they got that confused. They forgot who they were selling it to. They were trying to sell it to everybody when it really was for kids. You know, simple story, lot of action. That's all you need. And Michael Bay is really good at that.
Yeah.
He's one of the best. As much as you may hate him, he has a lot of great action movies with simple stories. The Rock, The Island, it's freaking pretty good stuff, man. Don't forget. So don't hate on him. Oh yeah, I still have more to talk about on this one. Clarity. Okay, this is another problem that I see in a lot of people's work that I try not to have in mind, which is people do a lot of loose work without really understanding what's in that loose work. Okay, everyone knows like Sparth, right? Huh. Like he does a lot of like abstract stuff and put like mountain textures on that stuff, and it looks good. It looks really good. But he understands what's going behind them, and so he can paint inside them. Does that make sense? Like he can go deeper into his painting if he needed to. And a lot of people just see that showy stuff, and then they just think that's what it takes to be a concept artist. No, it doesn't. Because people that have to look at your work have to make it. And so if you have nothing but black silhouettes everywhere, and like you have like this guy, and he's like mostly silhouette except for his helmet, and a character model has to model him, he's gonna be like, so when you drew that black shape, was that a leather or metal or a G-string? What the hell is that? You know, you gotta clarify for other people. You gotta understand that your artwork isn't yours. It's for everyone else as well. You're a team, okay? And you can't, I have this like, I remember when I first started, I had this stigma thinking that concept artists was like, we were rock stars in the industry. Like, yeah, we walk into the room, everyone bows down to us. Like, oh my God, the game would never be made without that. And that's also not true, you know? And once you get over that, once you realize you're a team player, you know, things move much smoother, things become much better. And you don't get your heart broken as much if you have that kind of mindset, realizing, okay, we're working for a greater cause. And that brings me to my next, the last one, which is inspire. All in all, even if your work has purpose and clarity, if it doesn't inspire people, then who cares? Like, who gives a fuck, really? And that's the greatest advice I've ever got from anybody, was when I was going to, it was at a Blizzard, a long time ago, Blizzard Mixer, when I was still a student, and I was like showing people my artwork, and it was terrible, but I thought it was so good. I was like, dude, check it out. And they're like, it's terrible. And I come to, you know, people say, do this, do that, and like, I've heard it over, and I was like, yeah, I'm still doing that, I'm practicing, but like, give me some more, like, is there anything about my design and this, you know, and they'd give me some great feedback. But the one that really stuck was what inspired this word to be put up here, which was, he looked at me and said, look, if your work doesn't inspire a whole team of people, you know, then you're not doing concept art. You gotta think that the art you're doing is gonna be looked by other artists, 3D artists, environment artists, animators, you know, even designers like to look at great, like, aesthetics. So if you don't have that in your work, and you don't inspire people to wanna work on it, you know, like, when I do, like, a dragon design, and, like, the animator sees it, and he's like, oh, I can totally see how this dragon can be animated, or, oh, I can totally see how you would shoot fire, or all this kind of stuff. When you have those kinds of conversations with people, that's when you're doing a good job, okay? If you just do it and they're like, all right, I guess I'll get it done, then the game's gonna feel like that, okay? So that's a big deal to me. So with all the technical stuff that I'm talking about, at the end of the day, guys, draw badass artwork, you know? Try to aspire to be a badass artist. Don't be a half and half, just getting the job done artist. Be the best possible artist you can be. And try to inspire people. Try to have a name for yourself with your designs, okay? Because that's what's gonna get you jobs. Because when someone looks at your website or your blog or your flashcards that you dropped on the ground, I don't know, I'm just trying to think of where else. The internet's pretty much where everything goes. You know, when they see it, like, you gotta imagine them saying like, whoa! You know, and you want that reaction from them, okay? And if you get that reaction, then you're going in the right direction. All right, moving on. Paint theory. So let's get more into like the skill set. And I say skill set because I truly think of painting as a skill, as an ability. Okay, as like a, if I wanted to become a really good plumber, as long as I learn all the tools of plumbing, I could become one. I feel painting is the same way. Okay. And there's a lot of thought behind painting where people are like, I like the mood that he went with. All this kind of, I didn't come from that, so I never saw that, okay? I just saw it for what it was, which was just a tool to design. That's all it was. And I always tell people to practice their basics. Because just like in anything, you need to practice your basics. There's nothing that I can think of where there's excellence that comes from where the people didn't practice basic something. Okay, there has to be basic business, basic astronomy, basic math, whatever you're trying to learn, you need to learn the basics before you can start advancing on them. And here's a good example of like really understanding practicing your basics. And I use this example a lot. So imagine we're a football team. This is like a 100-man football team, okay? No, let's not do that. Let's just say the first two rows. We're all part of a football team. And you know, we play a game maybe twice a week. Let's be hardcore. We play one game to practice every day. Oh, 2 hours of practice every day. And then we play the game on Saturday against the Chargers. I don't know, just some really good football team. Anyway, Carnage. We're just gonna put that there. I think that's a safe team. I won't get heckled. we will get devastated by the Chargers, right? Safe to say. But we practice 2 hours every day. Like, we were playing games. Why didn't we beat them? And the point is that we weren't really practicing our basics. We were just playing games. And we didn't really perfect those basics. Now, if you look at the team, like an NFL team, any NFL team, they have their quarterback throw a football like at their wide receivers like for like hours. Like, they're just like passing the ball over and over and over until the point where the quarterback almost can not even see the wide receiver, can even throw to him, right? And the wide receivers are just catching it behind my head, catching it between my legs, catching the ball. They have the linemen, they do the tire stuff, right? So that they get the reflexes like fast. They do like this for like 3-4 hours every day, and then they do a scrimmage, but the scrimmage is scrutinized, right? The scrimmage is like, you didn't do this play right, so do it again. And not only that, they hire people that practice this stuff on their own time. So there's the main practice, but everybody goes home and they practice some more. They practice their basics. And then when it comes game time, they start winning games. Because all of the stuff that they practice, all their basic fundamental instincts that they needed to play football is like all subconscious. It's all just in them. They can just do it. And essentially it goes back to what I said in the beginning of the lecture, which is hard work is really the secret, okay? And if you don't have strong basics, then you can't play the game as good as someone that has much better basics than you. You understand? And so I always say basics is so central to drawing well. And I still practice my basics to this day. There's no one that I know that I've met professionally that doesn't practice their basics. They don't practice, I don't know anyone that doesn't practice their anatomy, that doesn't practice their perspective, doesn't practice their values, their colors. I don't know anyone that professionally that just, no, you know what, I woke up one day and I looked at a tree and I said, I could paint that. I painted it. And I had an argument with my friend. He's like, because I have a really bad taste for the word talent. I think the word talent is misunderstood. I think people think that people are born with it. It's not, you're not born with it, you earn it. And so, so when people are like, well, what about naturally talented people like Leonardo da Vinci? You painting at the age of 12, like the masters. I was like, yeah, but do you know who Leonardo da Vinci is? Because I think you're just going off of a general statement. Because Leonardo da Vinci, at the age of 6, learned geometry because his mom and dad were like, you need to learn geometry. So he was learning all that for like the longest time. So he's already practicing drawing like perfect shapes at a very young age. And then also his parents enrolled him at the age of 8. So then 3 or 4 years later, he better be fucking good at painting because he's been doing it for 4 years. So if he's not that good, then he's like, you know, he's obviously not paying attention. His heart's not there. Michelangelo is another example of like people say that, well, he was naturally, right? No, he's just as hard worker. He used to steal people's paintings. He'd go into people's houses and say, steal their paintings and like trace over them and draw them. Right? When he did the David, he did hundreds and hundreds of iterations of the David. And it's just a naked guy standing with his like hand over his like shoulder, right? No, he designed that. He like spent hours and hours and hours and hours. The Sistine Chapel, obviously you guys know, he spent like almost his whole life painting that thing, right? And I love Michelangelo because he's a great example of like really hard work, because he used to build carts and like he would ride the carts out to the mountains and like chisel like mountain into the cart and then bring it back home. And then that was like a whole few days of like work just to get his medium. And he didn't even start. He's like, I need to get the greatest of mountains. And then I can start thinking about what I'm going to do. You know, and it's like, man, we have it easy, guys. We have the internet and Photoshop. So there's no excuse for bitching. Really, there isn't. And so I'm going to tell you guys one more story before and it's going to lead me to the next word position. You guys know Picasso, right? You guys heard of him? He's pretty good. Pretty well-known artist. Picasso, he was approached by this lady at like an art show. She's like, Picasso, I want you to do a drawing for me. You know, it doesn't have to be good. It doesn't have to be like, you could just do a real quick sketch. You know, I'll give you $100, you know. And he's like, okay, sure, $100, tight. And so he does this sketch in like 30 seconds. And then he hands it off to the lady, and the lady's looking at the sketch, and she's like, this is perfect. This looks just like me, you know, like the likeness is uncanny. And you did it like in 30 seconds. It's amazing. And he was like, 30? No. Like, it took me 30 years to do this drawing. Yeah. Right? And that's profound. essentially, what he was saying to the lady was, yeah, it practically, like, what he saw me do it was 30 seconds, but it took 30 years of my life to practice and train to be able to do this fast. Okay? And which brings me to like the next two words. We're gonna start with precision. Precision, which is practice makes perfect, right? You guys heard of that. But I would push it to another level where perfect practice makes perfect. Okay? Have you guys ever heard that? I know some people, I thought everybody heard this, but I guess some people didn't. They're like, what? I've never heard of that. I just put another word in there and it like changes everything. And you guys essentially understand what that means, right? I think it's pretty self-explanatory. You can practice something, but if you really put your heart into it and you practice it hard, then you can learn much more effectively, okay? You can be much more precise with your thing. So I think precision for me, whenever I paint, I try to get my edges clean and sharp. I try to get my colors accurate and effective. You know, I try to be as precise as possible, as accurate as possible whenever I'm studying. I try to figure out proportions. I like look at the proportions and I try to figure it out, you know? I'm like, what is it about the proportions that I'm getting wrong? You know? I don't just copy paste. Because if you copy paste, you will eventually learn that thing. But if you're drawing and then you're analyzing your drawing and you're trying to figure out why it's not so as precise as what you're studying, then you will get a lot of more value out of that learning. I always tell people to not copy and to always guess. I don't want you to do that. I want you to observe and have an opinion, okay? Because let's say we're gonna have a debate, all right? Let's say me and her, yeah, Veronica and I, we're gonna have a debate about abortion, right?
Oh, no.
And she's all about killing babies. She says, let's, if the woman wants the baby dead, it's still a fetus, it's all good, you know? And I'm like, no, you know, I want babies to live. I just had a baby, so I don't know, that's probably a little morbid, no time about abortion. But, you know, let's say we're having this argument, and she has a lot of facts, right? She has a lot of cases that are very factual and very intellectual, right? And she has studied her case and my case. She knows all of my arguments as well, right? She knows everything about abortion, everything. And all I know is just kind of what my parents raised me. They're like, killing babies is bad. That's all they told me. And I'm like, yeah, I grew up with that. So if we were having an argument in this room and everybody was watching, listening, whether you believe in abortion or not, you would listen to her and be like, she's got a pretty good point, right? And even if you don't agree with her, you'd still kind of be like, try to find an argument against her to kind of prove her wrong, but she's got it hard and strong, right? And so you're just like, oh my gosh. And that's kind of how I see art, is the same way. Whenever I look at someone's artwork, you know, I can tell that they didn't put factual and intellectual knowledge into their artwork. I can see that their anatomy is wrong. I can see that their perspective is wrong. In fact, a lot of people could see that without even having any artistic background, right? And that's why I say if you really put some facts and knowledge behind your artwork, then it starts becoming more of an opinion rather than like a copy, right? Like it's an opinion, because at the end of the day, the abortion argument is an opinion, right? And so if you have like knowledge behind what you do and what you say, then it's hard for people to disprove it. That's why when you look at really, really, really good artists that you guys all probably love, there's a lot of them, it starts becoming to the point where it feels like an illusion, right? Like it's like a magic trick. How the hell did they paint this thing, you know? And once you start breaking it down and going behind the curtains and figuring out how that they do that, it doesn't seem as hard. And you understand, I gotta work hard, you know? Like I've pulled a lot of curtains behind a lot of magic tricks, right, of these painters. And I'm like, well, what's the secret? And it always comes back to, oh, this guy's been painting for like 10 years. Oh, this guy has been drawing for 5 years. oh, this guy trained with a mask. He went back in time, learned from Leonardo da Vinci. crap. He built a time machine so he could do that. That took him 20 years. Yeah. It's like, it's always comes back to what I said at the beginning, hard work. And precision and efficient. Efficient comes back to what I like to do in my own painting. And I bring this up because, you know, I don't think people are efficient, and I think that's what slows you down. That's what makes you paint things forever when you shouldn't paint them forever, okay? Whenever you watch a master painter, how many master painters have you guys seen? Have you guys seen, like, how many people seen, like, four people paint, like, that are masters, like, in real life? Yeah, very few, right? That's, like, that's uncalled for, guys. Go to workshops, go to, like watch room. Like, people that can paint really good, watch them paint. And you'll start to learn that. It's not about noodling and doodling. They do it pretty, like, efficiently, right? I mean, for all the people that's seen them. Like, they when they go in there, they're like, so I draw a line, then I draw another one. Then I dab it, and then it's photoreal. And then you're like, what the hell? And it is. And you're looking at it, and it's photoreal. And you're like, what the hell happened? I blinked, and I missed the second dot. And so, this happened when I saw Steve Houston. Remember that?
Yes.
It was a 4-hour lecture, and 3.5 hours was just him talking about his work, and he was like, so I'm pretty much badass all my life. I don't know what I did this painting for the president. He's just like, he's going on, and it's like, it's pretty impressive, and we're just like, man, that's pretty cool. But we were running out of tape because we were filming him. And we're like, we told our instructor, hey, Charles, you know, he needs to, like, paint. We don't want to push him because he's dope, though. You do it. And Charles told us, oh, yeah, can you do a painting for us? And he's like, oh, yes, yes, yes. And he, like, spends, like, 5 minutes setting up his easel and all that stuff. And then he's like, I'm the fastest painter I know. And then he paints this, like, freaking crazy painting in 30 minutes, right? And it is, like, photoreal. It was so amazing. I was, like, blown away. And I think that was the day where I realized that the excuse for me painting as slow as I did I should not have that excuse anymore. I realized I don't really know what I'm doing, and that's why it took me forever to paint. That's what's taking me so long to paint the paintings that I want to paint. Because he knew exactly what he wanted and what he was doing, so he just did it. And I was like, wow. He painted this painting that he did faster than anything I could have painted back then, like in Photoshop, with all the tools and all that stuff. It's all about efficiency. And so since I'm talking about tools, I want to go back to basics. You know, I went to Nathan Folk's workshop, and he said something that I'm just going to steal what he said, because it pretty much nails it on the head, which essentially, he said, like, you know, as long as you practice your fundamentals, as long as you practice your basics, no matter what happens with the tools, like technology, like, you'll always be on top of it. Because you just will know what things look like, okay? And I agree with that, because if someone were to come in here, like, just run in right now and chop off my right hand for some reason, you're like, now you will never be an artist, right? I have a lot of confidence that in a few months, I can start drawing with my left hand just as good, maybe better, because I'm, like, retraining. Try to get rid of some of the bad habits that I had in my right hand. And because all the knowledge is in here, guys, it's not in your hand. Okay, we're not like a computer where if you lose part of your RAM, then all of a sudden your machine, like, dramatically takes a hit. I would just have to re-communicate to my left hand what my right hand has been doing for a while. And a good example of that is Frank Rosetta. Rest in peace, Mr. Frank Rosetta. He had a severe stroke, couldn't paint with his right hand anymore, so he just started painting with his left. And he was painting just as good. And so it's just like, it's not about your hands, it's about what you know. It really is. I saw a photo of, like, this guy painting with his feet, and it was freaking awesome. Yeah, you saw that? Yeah. Posted on Facebook, your Facebook friends, you probably saw it. And it's just like, yeah, man, like, he's like, I don't have arms, but I like to draw. That's not gonna stop me. And I love that. I love stories like that. Remember I was talking about Rocky? I love underdog stories, because they're the best. But anyway, that is my painting theory. So let's talk about practice, okay? So here's my 3 points about practice, what you need to do, which is essentially practice, practice, practice. there is nothing other than that. I think the main theme about this whole lecture so far is just like hard work and practice, right? And I'm gonna show you guys some painting techniques. I'm gonna paint and stuff, but I feel that a lot of what I'm gonna show you may go over some of your heads, you know. And I want to point out that it's not because you don't know nothing about art. It just means you just can't see how I'm doing it because you haven't gotten there yet. Okay, it's like a magic trick. But I'm going to explain it to you guys as much as possible. But I'm telling you how I got there and how everyone in this room can get there too. There's no one in here that I don't think can't be where they want to be if they don't work hard enough. And, you know, if you work hard, you're going to get where you want to go. And so what I did, essentially, like I told you guys before, is practice, practice, practice. For about a year of my art career, I was painting 10 to 12 hours every day, you know. And I want to talk about how I really learned practice, and it comes from a really unlikely source, but it's always a fun story to tell, which is I learned how to work hard and practice from World of Warcraft. Have you guys played that game?
Yeah.
World of Warcraft? If you haven't played it, I'm sure you've heard of it. It's that game that takes people's lives. It doesn't really like ruin your life. You just switch lives. That's what happens. You just become something else. And then your mortal form is just starts to deteriorate. Evaporating to the keyboard. So I, for 2 years, this is like when I was like in my early 20s, was playing nothing but this damn game, World of Warcraft. That game was so addicting. I remember the day that I got addicted to. I killed my first player. He was trying to kill me, and then I killed him. It was like, oh, the ultimate like underdog bully story, right? Like this, like someone's picking on me. They're a bigger level, and I took him down. Yeah, and I was like hooked for life. And so, since then, I was like all about killing players. I was like, I love killing players. I'll hunt them down, kill them. I spent like 2 hours watching a player just quest, and then like. Doesn't know what's gonna happen. I'm gonna unstealth and then re-stealth. And he's gonna be like, oh, like someone's around here. It was a lot of fun doing that. Me and my friends would do that together, hunt and stalk people. This is back before they started implementing a lot of what they have now. But back in the day, I loved killing players. I hated it when people killed me. And so what I did was like I played every class to like level 60. So I can learn every single class, what their secrets were, what their weaknesses and their strengths were. And then I was like, back to one of my favorite class, which was the rogue. And then I was like, okay, I can't beat the hunter because he keeps doing that damn flare. And my main strength is my stealth, and it destroys my stealth, you know, and I was like freaking out. And so I was doing like research, I went online, I was reading about it, what other people did, and I was like, oh, okay, figure out how to kill hunters. And I started realizing that they had this frost trap. If you step into it, you get frozen and they get distance. That was the thing, like hunters had distance, and that was my weakness. And I learned from lots of